are running rampant throughout our country and how we can move away from awareness to taking action. Warriors Talk will empower listeners by keeping them informed, connected to services, and encourage them to thrive while surviving.
Welcome to Warriors Talk. I am your host, Lady Rochelle, and I'm so excited you have chosen to tune in today. It is Testimonial Tuesday, and I am inviting everyone to join me on all forms of social media. Facebook/Warriors Talk with the Ness, Twitter @Warriors Talk 1, Instagram Warriors Talk 1. You can email me with show ideas at warriorstalk1@gmail.com. And you can also follow me on Spreaker if you ever miss a live broadcast of the show. Just go to Spreaker.com, and that's Spreaker.com. Follow me and I will follow you back. You can also subscribe to my channel on YouTube, Warriors Talk with Lady Rochelle, as I keep my eyes on the community to let you know what's going on in the community as it relates to cancer and other diseases that are plaguing our community. And as always, we dedicate the show to an individual. In this particular show, I want to dedicate it to First Lady Rhonda Kelly. I found out last night that she is getting ready to go through her journey with breast cancer. So I just want to wish her well on her journey, that God would preserve, heal, and restore her and give her a testimony so that she can help others that may be starting off on this path. And last week, we discussed on Warriors Talk when cancer attacks the heart, physically and emotionally. We were able to break down how the body reacts to stress and how stress can be a silent killer if not controlled. Stress on the heart is a stressed body, which leads to disease. So if you could take anything away from that particular show, please learn how to control your stress and apply different life-saving strategies that would help you minimize stress so that you can live a stress-free life. Our healing verse is coming from Psalms 41, 2 and 3. And this is the NLT version. The Lord protects them and keeps them alive. He gives them prosperity in the land. And he rescues them from their enemies. The Lord nurses them when they are sick and restores them to health. And we're going to listen to a clip, How to Stop Cancer from Returning.
Hi, everyone. I'm Raymond Francis. And I'm the author of the breakthrough book, Never Fear Cancer Again, How to Prevent and Reverse Cancer. And today, I want to talk about a very serious subject. If you've had cancer, how do you prevent it from returning? A cancer diagnosis often inspires people to exercise and to eat healthier. Now the experts say there's strong evidence that both habits help to prevent the disease from coming back. More than 90% of all cancer is caused by controllable factors such as diet and lifestyle. That's why it doesn't come as a surprise that the American Cancer Society recently urged doctors to talk to their cancer patients about eating right, exercising, and slimming down if they're too heavy. Yet that's not something most doctors do, because they simply don't know any better. They're focused on surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation, and other standard treatments for their patients, completely ignoring the critical effects of diet and lifestyle. Now, in Never Fear Cancer Again, I explained why healthy eating and exercise prevent cancer. Thankfully, it also is a way to help prevent cancer from coming back if you've already had it, so you can both prevent it and stop it from coming back. The last 5 years has seen more than 100 studies involving cancer survivors, with many of them showing that exercise and or good diet was associated with lower cancer recurrence rates and longer survival. The evidence is becoming overwhelming that diet and exercise can help to prevent cancer, and that's why the Cancer Society is now recommending them. As for exercise, rebounding, this is bouncing on a mini trampoline, is something almost anyone can do in the privacy of their home at any time of the day. I've written about rebounding in my books, and there is an article on my website at beyondhealth.com explaining why it's so good and how to do it. While getting some people to do exercise is a challenge, getting them to change their diet is an even greater challenge. But your life may depend on it. So if you want to live, you really don't have a choice. Again, in Never Fear Cancer Again, I tell you about how to eat a good diet, how to choose good supplements, how to get the exercise you need. Very importantly, get the sugar and the dairy products and the processed oils out of your life now. If you've had cancer and you don't want it to come back, two things you need to do is regular exercise and eat a good diet. You need to educate yourself about how to do that. And you can do it by reading my books. I'm wishing you well in your endeavors. I'm Raymond Francis. Thank you for listening.
So I'm not going to delay her any longer. So we have sitting with us a three-time cancer survivor. She currently sits on the board of directors of All About Pink Breast Cancer Foundation, a member of the Women's Color of Guilders Club Cancer Support Group, Resurrection House of Recovery Home. She participates in the Avon Walk for 5 years, and she recently was featured in a video with the University of Chicago. And it was called Walk Through the Cure. And she was also on Channel 7 with Roz, who we know is also a breast cancer survivor as well. So I am excited to bring to you, to Warriors Talk, Virgie Gentry, a three-time cancer survivor.
Hello, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Oh, I'm blessed by the best.
Awesome. And I'm so excited because Virgie has brought supporters with her. And we always talk about your support system. And I'm going to let them introduce themselves really quick. Come on, supporters.
Hi, I'm Monica Ryder.
Hi, I'm Julia Paul.
And it's nice to meet you, ladies. I'm glad you came out to support your friend. I'm excited to hear your journey, and I know everybody else is. So I'm going to let you just take us on your journey.
Well, it started in 1997. Thank you, Lord. I was leaving church one Saturday afternoon, and I was walking out the door, and I pushed the door with my right arm, and when I did that, I hit my breast, and I said, ouch. And one of the members asked me what was wrong, and I told her that I hit my breast and it hurt it. She said, what happened? I said, oh, I feel a knot in my breast. And then she told me, you need to go get that checked out. So I eventually went and got it checked out. And they told me, because I was so young, it was nothing to worry about. It's just a cyst. And that they would do a needle acceleration to draw the fluid from it.
And how old were you at that time?
I was 35 at that time.
Okay.
And so, well, we went to the procedure of doing that, and unfortunately it wasn't. So I had to go to the breast clinic, and they did a biopsy, and I was told 3 days later that I have stage 3 breast cancer.
Wow. So that was the first diagnosis.
Yes.
What was going through your mind when you heard those 3 devastating words? You have cancer.
Lord, why me? I'm not ready to die yet. I can't give up right now, Lord. Help me, Jesus.
And we all have those why me moments.
Yes.
What got you past that why me moment?
Well, my late pastor, Eugene L. Gibson from the Mission of Faith Baptist Church, I just cried and cried and cried. So he took me in the office and he asked me, baby, what's wrong? And I went to share my story with him. So he sat me down and he talked to me. And he gave me his testimony about his open heart surgery. So he said, well, if you can give this disease to 3 people right now, who would you give it to? Give me 3 names.
Oh, wow.
Well, I thought about it. I hesitated. I couldn't think of no one. So he said, what's taking you so long, baby? Mm-hmm. I said, well, he said, so why not you?
Wow.
I said, but why me? He said, why not you? You couldn't give me nobody else. So why not you? Then he told me the story of Job. Mm. And that what got me through. But I still went home and I cried. A mother of 6.
Oh, wow.
Young kids. Oh, I cried. And I cried out to God. But what really got me through was I was crying so long. Yolanda Adams' song came on. Mm-hmm. The battle is not yours, mm-hmm. it's the Lord.
I love that
and
song.
And I just shouted all over the house, mm-hmm. and I got my breakthrough that day. Mm-hmm. And I was able to stand and fight this disease. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think everybody have those moments to where they know that they're going to be okay, like God gives you this peace.
Yes.
And you know, okay, from this point on, I got my boxing gloves on, I got my war paint on, it's wartime. And you go into this zone, and you don't come out of that zone until you're done with everything. Once you come out of that zone and you put down your weapon, the weapons, should I say, with an S, the emotions kick in.
Yes.
What did you do mentally? Because it could be very depressing. Cancer is a very devastating disease.
Yes,
it takes over your whole entire life.
Yes.
Not just your life. You have cancer and your family has cancer too.
Yes.
So what got you through those moments where you felt like you just want to have a mental breakdown?
At that time, my church family, I didn't know anything about support group. I didn't want to talk to no one. I didn't feel ashamed. I just felt like didn't nobody need to know what I was going through. I didn't mm-hmm. want a pity party at mm-hmm. that time. So I relied on my church family who got me through, you know, who was my support, my biggest support. And then a year later, my pastor died.
Oh, wow.
I was like, no, how dare you leave me like this, mm-hmm. you know. And I had to stand on my own after that. And I stood on my own and I had to go through chemotherapy because the tumor was rapidly growing. One hospital suggested I have a mastectomy. I didn't know anything about that.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, I think I need to get a second opinion, in which I did.
Mm-hmm.
And, well, I follow up now. I was able to, I had options.
Okay.
You know, I had options. So I asked the doctor, what would you do? You know, I'm 35. I have 6 kids at home. What would you do? So she said, well, I would do the chemo first and see, can we shrink it?
Mm-hmm.
So I had 4 treatments of chemo. And lo and behold, after the second treatment of chemo, everything was gone. The lump was gone.
Oh, wow.
I'm not going to say the diagnosis, but I still had to take the chemo.
Mm-hmm.
But the lump was gone, and the doctors was like, wow, we never seen anything like that. So that's what God, that was God telling
yes.
me then, that, hey, I'm
I got
here,
you, right.
You know? Just trust and believe in me. I mm-hmm. had your back, you know. So I still had to complete the other 2 rounds of chemo, which I did,
mm-hmm.
Following radiation. And I had a support group. I have God put people in your life for a reason and a season. Mm-hmm. And I had my church family, which I still attend, the Mission of Faith Baptist Church, but I also had some more family members, and they was there for me. They was there for the kids, mm-hmm. you know. In right. my mental state of mind, they just took care of the kids for me. And I was able to, you know, do what I had to do and get back on track.
And not have to have that cloud over your head worrying about who's going to take care of my babies, yes. who's going to feed them, who's going to pick them up from school, yes. who's going to take them here. How did you break the news to your kids? What was that like?
You know what? I the first time I really can't remember. They were too young to understand, but I have a couple of older ones at that time, and they was right there for me, and they just embraced me and held me and, you know, took care of me. They really took care of me because the first time, stage 3, mm-hmm. I was in and out the hospital. And when I came home with the hospital.
Oh,
so they knew my pain. Mm-hmm. They was right there. My youngest daughter, she couldn't have been no more than 9 or 10 years old. She was right there, just stayed up under me, told me how much she loved me, mm-hmm. you know, prayed for me when I couldn't pray for myself.
How old was she?
At the time, she was like 9 years old.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes, she was. Yes, wow. she was. Yeah.
Yeah, children are a blessing.
Yes.
I can remember having a bald head, and the little one, she could always say, "I love your hair, Mommy." And I'm like, "I have no hair." She goes, "Your hair is pretty." And I'm like, "There's no hair here." But, you know, that's what she saw.
Yes.
I don't know what she saw,
yeah.
but that's what she would tell me. And it would just, you know, make me feel so good because I'm just like, "There's no hair on my head," but she's still telling me that I'm beautiful.
Yeah.
So children are a blessing. And it could be devastating to tell them because, you know, they have these fears. I mean, especially if you're a single parent. I was a single parent going through my diagnosis. So if you're a single parent going through it, you're the one person that they're depending on.
Yes.
So it's like their whole environment is being threatened if something happens to you. Thank God that you had an awesome support team. You had your church and then you had other people that was able to take care of you.
Yes.
Can you remember, can you go back and remember, like, what was a low point for you?
The low point for me was when I went to the doctor and I had to be admitted in the hospital. And I had to get home to my babies.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking that, Lord, if you take me now, who gonna love my babies like I'm gonna love them? Who gonna treat them like I'm gonna treat them? And my prayer was to God was, if you don't do anything else, allow me to live to see mm-hmm. my babies grow old,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I'm still here.
Amen. So you got past the one diagnosis.
Yes.
What happened with the second one?
Well, in June of 2004, I was just going for a routine mammogram. And I made a statement when I left work, because I was starting vacation that Friday, and I remember it was a Thursday. Mm-hmm. And I made a statement to my supervisor, "Well, you won't see me tomorrow. I'll see you the week after next when I come from vacation." He said, "Oh, Virgil, you'll be here." I was like, "Oh, no, I won't. My vacation starts now." Well, I was just playing. So when I got to the doctor, had my mammogram, where I go in Northwestern, you cannot leave until you get the results.
Mm, oh, wow.
So I sat around. I'm like, okay, how will them pass? I want to have them pass. They're like, "Miss Gentry, we need more pictures." Okay, another hour done passed. I'm nervous now.
Mm-hmm.
They said, "Miss Gentry, we need to go have an ultrasound." I'm like, "What's wrong?" They said, "Oh, nothing. We just want to, you know, check your left breast this time." I was like, "So what's going on?" They was like, "Well, we need a biopsy." I just broke down right there. My question was, why me?
Now, did you experience a biopsy with the first one?
Yes.
So you knew what to expect.
Mm-hmm,
okay.
So I had to come back the next day for a biopsy. So I called the job and said, well, guess what? I won't be there. And I explained to my supervisor what was going on. So I was told that I had stage 2 triple negative breast cancer. And stage 2, because the lump, it wasn't big enough for me to have chemo, but they said, since I was still young, 7 years later, it wasn't related, mm-hmm. that they suggested I do the chemo.
It wasn't related.
It wasn't the, it wasn't related to the first breast, to the first cancer.
Okay.
So I did the, I think I did maybe 6 weeks of chemo. And it was a lighter dose, but it still took my hair out and whatever. But again, I had people in my life for a reason and a season. And they took very, very, very good care of me. Very, very good care of me. And my kids was grown at the time. Yes. And I'm here again.
Wow. So you go through one cancer diagnosis. You were able to get through that. Now here you are with the second diagnosis. What was your emotional state at that point?
What did I do wrong? I exercised. I was at the gym 5 days a week. I was eating very healthy. Why me? What did I do wrong, Lord? Tell me. And he said, why not you? It's some people that need to see you going through what you're going through. Because at that time, I had already been with, if I'm not mistaken, 2 ladies when they took their last breath.
Oh, wow.
So while I was going through, my cousin was going through. She couldn't handle it. So I guess that was the reason why he allowed me to go through it again, to show them that, yes, you can handle it. Mm-hmm. You could be strong about it. Whatever you do, don't give up. You know, so I just don't know. I was asking God, Lord, what are you doing? What's going on? What are you trying to tell me? What do you want me to do? Then here's another young lady. Everybody want to call on Virgie.
Mm-hmm.
Can you come and be with me? I'm going through it. Why do I need to be with you? You worse off than me. Why do I need to be there with you? God said, peace be still.
Mm.
But I ran back and forth to the doctor like, oh, Lord, something going on with me. I'm feeling it, you know. And my oncologist told me that, no, God is using you right now.
Oh, wow.
You it's nothing you could say. Just be there for them. And it took me through, I think, 7 women. No. At that time, 4 women. They had died before I wrestled with telling my story publicly and openly to anybody about what I went through. My church members, they had been there with me and didn't even know that I had battled breast cancer twice.
Wow. It was just a personal choice. You didn't want to...
Well, I thought everybody knew. I mean, I wasn't ashamed of my bald head, but I didn't wear a bald head. Mm-hmm. I had a wig on, and that was just most worse off than anything. But
you didn't embrace your bald head?
No. At home, I did. Behind closed doors, I did. But no. But at that time, I have to say, like I say, I wrestled with God about what is it that He want me to do. You know, here I am. Why everybody want to talk to me? Why do they want to hold my hand? Why do I have to hold their hand until they take their last breath? Is you showing me this is how death gonna be? I don't want it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want it. And then I met a young lady at Old Navy. When I walked through the door, we ran to each other like we knew each other, like we've been knowing each other. And we stood in that store for about an hour and a half, and she shared her journey and I shared mine.
Wow.
And then 3 days later, I met another young lady in the LA Fitness. And we were supposed to have been working out, and we sitting there crying and telling our journey. And then it had to take me back to my church member. Mm. Anita Stewart Montgomery. She came to me. Someone sent her to me. And she told me that she was diagnosed with breast cancer. And what should she do? So we talked. We went out to lunch and we talked and we talked. And then she told me, well, my sister have it too. She had it before me, but she won't go to the doctor.
Oh.
I was like, oh, she was like, oh, you have to talk to her.
Wow.
And I was like, hold on, what you mean you're not going to the doctor? I was like, girl, we're going to beat this and we're going to beat this together. I will hold your hand. I will walk your journey with you.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to do this together. And we did. And we did. And that's when I wrestled again. And I went to my pastor at that time, Pastor Gregory Livingston, and I shared my journey with him and shared everything that I'm sharing with you. And I said, I think I need a support group because all these women want to talk to me and they're all on my time now. So how can I do this? He said, well, do it once a month. And that's what Matters at Heart was for.
Oh, wow. So God was preparing you the
That's
whole time because you wouldn't have been able to relate to any of these women coming to you.
Yes.
Because you wouldn't know how to minister to them.
Yes.
So this is, I mean, this is your ministry. So he was preparing you.
That's what he was doing. Wow.
So he had to strip you.
Yes.
And he had to have you to lean and depend on him only.
Yes.
So that he could get you to a place to where you could hear his voice.
Yes.
And call out to him.
Yes.
Remove all the noise. So now you're able to minister to these women and tell them exactly what they need to know, the raw truth. Hold their hands, go with them. Because
yes.
Let's face it, women don't like to get mammograms.
Sure not.
It's a fear.
Yes.
Going to get those mammograms because
yes.
You don't want to hear.
Yes.
You're just afraid that you're going to hear something negative.
Yes.
So they rather not know than know. But we know that in the African American community, most of the time when we go, they diagnose us at a stage 4.
Yes.
We always are diagnosed in the later stages.
Yes.
So it's important to, they say the age is 45. I say don't wait. You're doing your monthly exams. You're going to the doctor yearly. They doing exams. And then if it runs in your family, you know 10 years before whoever was diagnosed,
yes.
Then you go and get your mammograms. But doing your monthly exams, you begin to know what your norms are. You begin to know what's normal and what's not. So when you feel something that's not normal the next month, if it lasts more than 3 weeks, you should be going to your doctor.
Yes. And they like, I'm scared. What are you scared of? You don't even know what you're being scared of.
Mm.
Go to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Take the mammogram. You don't know what you're being scared of. You don't even know. The doctor don't tell you nothing wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? That's what they tell them most of the time.
Exactly. And God takes us through this journey for a reason. But we have to remember that everything that we go through is for his glory.
Yes.
And we're going to listen to For Your Glory by Tasha Cobbs.
Yes.
Lift your worship now. Find favor in your sight, Lord, please hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting to be where you are. Across the hottest desert, I will do anything. to see you, to behold you as my King. Favor in your sight, Lord, please, Lord, please, hear my heart's cry. I'm desperately waiting just to be where you are. Cross the hardest test. Just say I'll travel near or far.
My King, I wanna be where you are. where you are. Joy is where you are. And love is who you are.
Whether you need home, car, life, renters, or business insurance, Paula Kelly and her staff specialize in all your insurance needs. Paula Kelly Allstate Insurance Agency is located at 297 East Glenwood, Lansing Road, Glenwood, Illinois. Give her a call today, 708-758-3300, or email her at paulakelly@allstate.com, P-A-U-L-A-K-E-L-L-Y @allstate.com, or show her some love and like her on Facebook and get your quotes for what you need today. You're in good hands with Allstate.
The Emmanuel Church of God in Christ, Pastor Michael A. Richardson serves as our pastor. Emmanuel is located at 3058 West Van Buren in Chicago, Illinois, 60612. Order of services on Sundays at 9:30 a.m. is Sunday school. Morning worship takes place at 11 a.m. Every first Sunday, we have pastoral prayer at 9 a.m. and Holy Communion is served after the morning worship service. Join us for Bible studies on Wednesdays, 6:45 for prayer and 7 for the Bible Institute classes. Join us at Emmanuel, where we are building upon a solid foundation.
And we are back. This is Lady Richelle on Warriors Talk, and we are talking to three-time cancer survivor, Virgie Gentry. Hello, Virgie. I am enjoying your testimony, and I know everybody else is as well. Virgie was telling us about the first and second time that she heard those three devastating words, "You have cancer." And she's about to take us through her third journey with cancer.
Well, before I get to the third journey, I have to say that I thought after my first battle, cancer was ended. Then I thought after the second round, no more cancer. And that's when I started meeting people and doing what I do. And I'm not a speaker. I'm not a talker. I don't like to talk. But they bring it out of me. And I have one survivor friend. She tells me, "I don't like you because now you have me speaking to people."
Oh, wow.
So I just tell them what my late pastor told me. When you feel like you can't go no further and you feel like you're at the end of your rope, just tie a knot. Tie a knot and just hold on a little while longer because help is on the way. Amen. Jesus never leave you or he will never forsake you. And I believe that. I believe that. And I'm not different from no one else because he could take me in the blink of an eye. Mm-hmm. But I thank him that I'm still here because somebody need to hold my hand. I need to hold somebody's hand to let them know that life goes on. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And I know the road might get rough and it might get hard. It's all right to cry. It's all right to cry.
So God got you to a place to where you had no choice but to lean and depend on him.
Lean and depend on him.
Where did that take your faith?
I just had to share it. I couldn't sit still. I couldn't sit on it. I couldn't sit on my blessing. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I didn't know what it was. But then as I started meeting younger women, younger than 35, that blew my mind. That blew my mind. It took me to another place that I have daughters. Mm. It could have been one of them. Thank God. But all the young ladies, they still here.
Amen.
Like I said, through my journey, I done met. When I meet people, they just love on me. Can't ask me why, because I don't know. Everybody say I'm the meanest person they is, but... But that's another story. But God, you know, but God. But We done lost a couple of them. Yvonne mm-hmm. Cyrus Guest. She died a couple of years ago. I was with her and her family. Had just met the young lady a year before that. She came to the Celebration of Life service that we have at our church every fourth Sunday in October, just to celebrate life. And after that, her health started failing her. And within that year, I walked her journey with her until she took her last breath. And then my sister, church member, Anita Stewart Montgomery, mm-hmm. she left us, and she sang herself all the way home to the day she took her last breath. And that was May 25th. No, that was Memorial Day last year.
Oh, wow.
When I say she sang herself, she said she was in the bed. And she was like, hold on, I want to come down the stairs. Oh, it took four of us. She was a petite woman. It took four of us to get her down five steps. And she sang her way to glory.
Wow.
Oh, boy. That just broke my heart. We, Matters at Heart, still mm-hmm. recovering from that.
Wow.
We still recovering from that one.
Well, I have my co-host on the line, Rizal Gilmore. Rizal.
Hello, Lady Rochelle. Hello, Warriors Talk.
Hello.
Now, Rizal actually lost his wife to breast cancer. She had breast cancer that went to her brain. And then her anniversary just passed. And was it Father's Day weekend? Made it 3 years that your wife passed away.
3 years. It was June 14th
last week. Okay. So, Rizal, we're talking to Virgie, three-time cancer survivor, and she has a unique story, unlike any other, and I'm just excited to hear this third part.
Well, that takes me back to every year I have a mammogram and an MRI. And I've been doing that for the last 10 years. Last 4 years, the MRI, I had to have a biopsy following it. Calcification. Oh, we don't understand. It couldn't be. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, it couldn't be. Not in your case. You mm-hmm. done dealt with cancer in both breasts and down calcification. This is impossible, but God.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was good. The next year. A mammogram. I take the MRI in March, take the mammogram in October. So the next year, it was time for the mammogram. Well, we see a spot in your right breast now.
Mm.
No, we see a double spot. This was last year, March 20, right before my birthday, March 11.
Oh, wow.
This the pill I had to swallow for my birthday. This was my birthday present.
Wow, happy birthday to
yes.
you.
We see a double spot on your right breast,
mm-hmm.
and we need to react on it as soon as possible. I was like, Lord, Lord, here we go again. What's mm-hmm. going on? But he said, peace be still.
Mm-hmm.
So he gave me that peace. Can't nobody explain it. Can't nobody felt the peace that I felt when I went in there, into that room to get that biopsy. And guess what? It was benign.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Okay, so now here we go again. 6 months later, I had the MRI. That was good. 6 months later, I had the mammogram last year, October. Well, Miss Gentry, we see a new spot, and it's not benign, and it's not calcification.
Mm.
But there's no need to worry. Mm. We want to see you back in 6 months. Oh, no. No, no, no. That's what they told my sister Anita, that they want to see her back in 6 months. And then when she came back after 2 months, it was stage four.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
And her cancer went to her brain, then went back down, then came back up, then went back down, and she left. Oh, no, you won't see me in 6 months.
Mm-mm.
If I could come back next month, I will.
Mm-hmm.
So, oh, no, your insurance not going to cover that. I said, okay, we'll see.
Wow.
So I waited to January, and I said, I'm calling for my appointment. They were like, oh, no, I don't think your insurance will pay for it. Well, let me call my insurance.
Mm-hmm.
They said, yes, Ms. Gentry, long as it's not the 3D image, you could get a mammogram when you want.
Okay.
Make my appointment, please. So they was like, well, Ms. Gentry, we still see it. So now we have to react on it. We need a biopsy. Okay, well, let's do it. So I'm like, well, I'm pretty sure it's calcification. I'm not going to worry about it. I know who my God is. Mm-hmm. So I get the call Friday. I just got off work. I listened to my voicemail. Hi, Virgie. This is such and such. I need you to call me back. Mm-hmm. I have your results for you. I said, okay. Okay. So I was like, Lord, whatever it is, my life is in your hand. So I called back, and she was like, Virgie, I know you was all excited. You know, you was hoping that it was calcification, but I'm sorry. It's not. Mm. It's a new cancer, and it's an early stage. Stage DCIU, and that's stage zero. Mm. I said, so where do we go from here? She said, well, you need to call your surgeon and your oncologist. Now, after 18 and a half years, my oncologist said, you good. We don't need to see you no more. I was like, oh, the devil's a lie. I need to talk to somebody. Wow. So she just released me. She was like, you could go to your neighborhood clinic. I said, but I have to keep up with my MRIs and my mammograms. She's like, no problem. So here we go again. So I was like, well, you call her because I don't even want to talk to her.
Wow.
So I called my surgeon, and we talked. We laughed. I took my daughters with me. I have four girls. Three went with me. They've been having their mammograms every year.
Good.
Like you said, yes. They had to start taking their mammograms at 25. Mm-hmm. But the doctors refused some of them for a couple of years. But they good. Okay. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
So I went to the surgeon. I said, so now what? She said, Virgie, you done did good this far. You tell me. I said, so what you think? She said, well, you really don't have to do none. Stage zero is at a good stage. I said, well, doc, I think I'll be playing Russian roulette with my life. I said, since I done been to so many conferences, done sat into so many listeners, so many medical experts about double mastectomy, done been around so many women that had it, you know, give me some new girls. It's time. Let's go. She was like, are you sure? Do you want one or two? Don't take one.
Take them both. These things tried to kill me.
Yes.
Three times.
Yes. I was like, let's get rid of them. You know, she was like, but the left one is good. No, it's not. No, it's not. It's not good. It might be good for you, but it's not good for me.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go. So that's what I did. So I had the surgery February 25th of this year, and I'm still in recovery from that. I'm healing well. God is good. And,
amen.
I'm still on the battlefield because since then, I done came upon five ladies.
Oh.
Since then, just got recently diagnosed. So
wow.
I'm still doing what I'm doing.
Oh, wow.
Encouraging them to hold on and be strong.
Wow. Now, Rizal, I know you love to hear the stories. So I know this story has got to be blowing your mind right now.
Oh, always. You know, I've listened since she first started. And, you know, I can honestly say I ask those same questions. Lord, why my wife? You know, why our family? And it wasn't until years later that I discovered something. I discovered me. And sometimes you have to bury things and let them go. And the fight really isn't the cancer. It's the fight of the changes that's what's about to occur in your life. And I was fighting to let go of the old me so I can become the new me. But if all what happened in my life didn't happen, I would have never became the person who I am. So everything happens for a reason.
Yeah.
And everything has a purpose. And if it wasn't for, you know, me going through the situation with my wife, I would never discover the passion or the purpose that I have for helping people and trying to influence them and trying to inspire them and keep them motivated with the will to want to keep going and want to live. And I feel as though what you're doing now, that's your job. You've also has now joined the ranks to spread your story and help other people as well, just as, you know, Lady Rochelle, Warriors Talk, the Gal Foundation, and so on and so on.
Yes.
Yes, Virgie has matters at heart, and I want her to tell us about that so some of the women can know how to get in contact with her.
Yes, well, like I said, it's Matters at Heart Breast Cancer Support Group. We meet every fourth Saturday at Mission of Faith Baptist Church from 1 to 3 p.m., 11321 South Prairie, on the south side in the Roseland neighborhood. And it is just outstanding because we just not have survivors. We have supporters. We have women in a community because they want to know, you know, what's mm-hmm. going on, you know. And the women's in the Roseland area need to know about the landfill over there because the breast cancer that's coming about now is environmental. It's not oh, wow. a family history because
yes.
it's not, it's in my family, but where, you know, but most of it is environmental.
So you test negative for that bronchial?
No, I test positive.
You did? Okay.
Yes. Uh-huh. And, but I'm not saying, I don't know, you know, back then our grandparents took them
right.
to the grave with them.
Yes.
So we don't know, you know, they
true.
Kept that silent.
That's true.
So I can say maybe I am the first in my generation,
mm-hmm.
in
mm-hmm.
my generation. But it's just, you know, I like to get out in the Roseland community. I don't live in Roseland area, but I was born and raised in that community, you know.
Okay.
And just to share the good news and just let them know, hey, when you look at me, you're looking at a miracle.
And a miracle three times over.
Yes.
Jesus.
Yes, and if he did it for me, he'll do it for you. But you got to hold on. You got to tie that knot. You got to hold on. So like I said, we meet every fourth Saturday. I have one of my survivors here with me, Monica Ryder.
Hi, Monica.
And I have my biggest supporter, Julie, because her mom is a 30-year survivor.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yes, Mama
okay.
Paul.
All right.
Yes. Mama Paul is a 30-year survivor.
Amen.
And when you see her, oh, you talking about a sweetie pie? Oh, my God. And we all just love on each other. We cry together. We laugh. We talk. Some women's coming there. They don't feel like coming. One month, we doing T-shirts. We might do painting. You know, oh, what I'm doing is for, I don't know. What you want me to do? With I don't know. Here's the paint. And guess what? It's so beautiful. And they just talk and they cry. Well, guess what? I didn't feel like coming here today. But God brought you here for mm-hmm. a reason. He brought you here for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then we have a fundraiser once a year because after the death of Yvonne Cyrus Guest and then after the death of Anita Stewart Montgomery, they have young kids. Yvonne have a daughter now. Sydney is 11, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But she have a daughter that just graduated out of high school last week.
Oh, wow.
So I was like, okay, Lord, I want to do the fundraiser. And when I started the fundraiser, it was just for us to get out and just dress up and
mm-hmm.
just enjoy ourselves,
right.
you know, once a year. You know, let's look pretty in pink once
mm-hmm.
a year. Or let's have a hat-a-tude where you put your mm-hmm. hat on and you bring your attitude with it.
Right.
So they love that. So after the death of Anita, I was like, you know what? With the money, I don't want to hold on to it. I want to give it to the kids. So that's what I do.
Right.
That's what we do, not I. It's not about me.
Mm-hmm.
We raise the money and we get scholarships to the kids of a surviving.
Oh, family. Wow. Giving back.
Yes.
Or
they mom died from breast cancer, but they have to meet the standards, you know.
Okay.
A senior in high school and a first or second year of college, and we'll take them to the second year of college.
Wow.
And let them know that we love them. We still care.
That's a blessing. Oh, my goodness. What else you have coming up?
And I have a bowl for the cure. It's Saturday, July 9th from 7 to 11 at Bluebird Lane, 3900 South Columbus Avenue. And that's between 87 and Pulaski in the crossroad. And it's $20 to get it per person, and that's for unlimited bowling. You get your free shoes, you have food. We're gonna definitely have a raffle, the highest score win, and more. And all the proceeds go to the Anita Stewart Montgomery and Yvonne Cyrus Guest Scholarship Fund.
Amen. So I'll be putting her flyer up on my page, you guys. So if you want to get more information about that, and I'll also put the information about Matters at Heart. Virgie, thank you so much for sharing your testimony. Can you please give us some words of wisdom to someone who's maybe just getting ready to go through their journey or have a second diagnosis?
Again, just when you feel like you're at the end of your rope, when you can't do no more, when you cried all you can cry, all the tears you can cry, just tie a knot on that rope and just hold on a little while longer. And I have to leave you with this. Never be ashamed of your scars that life has left you with. A scar means that the hurt is over, the wound is closed, you endured the pain, and God has healed you.
Amen. I like Amen. That. Rizal.
Yes.
30 seconds. Words of wisdom.
Words of wisdom. Always remember, worry is a waste of energy. It can't change the past, but it can control your future. It only makes today miserable. Be a warrior, not a worrier.
Amen. I like that.
Yes.
I like that. And we can never be sure that cancer will return. Even if you exercise, eat right, keep your appointments, there's no guarantee that cancer would not return. So we have to make sure that we stay on top of our health, be our own best self health advocate, and stay positive and make sure that you have, again, your support system around you. So warriors, we're going to leave you with this. Keep thriving while surviving.
Gracious God, our Father, we come before you with praise and with thanksgiving. We praise you because you have been so good and so merciful unto us. From morning by morning, new mercies we've seen, and everything we needed, your hands have provided. Great is your faithfulness towards us. We thank you, Lord, for this open door and this opportunity to bring hope and inspiration to so many. We thank you, Lord, for Sister Rochelle and how you have saved her so that she can be used to save others. And we thank you, Lord, for how you have healed her so that she can be used to bring healing and awareness to so many. Tonight we ask, O God, that you will extend your mercy over the airways into every place where this prayer can be heard. You said in your word in 1 John 5:14, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. So tonight we're praying, O God, in your will, and we're praying, God, for healing. We're praying, God, for deliverance. We're praying that you would encourage the discouraged. We're praying, O God, that you would bring peace to those that have been distressed. We're praying, God, that you would bring comfort to those who may be hurting in their body even now. We're praying, O God, that you would curse cancer to the core and that you would bring deliverance to your people. We're praying, God, that you would just have your way, Lord. For God, you made us, you created us, God, and Lord, you're able to repair us and to make us whole. So we pray, O God, that you will drive every trace of sickness and disease out of our bodies right now. God, we're praying that the blood will prevail. Hallelujah. Let your blood that was shed on Calvary's cross intervene right now. Let the blood of Jesus, God, give us healing and make us whole. Oh, God, this is our prayer tonight. Have your way, God. Bring deliverance, God. Bring wholeness, God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Thank God. Amen.
You have just tuned in to Warriors Talk with your host, Lady Rochelle. Warriors, remember, early detection, knowing your risk, reducing your risk, knowing your family history, and selecting healthier lifestyle choices are keys to saving lives. And always remember to thrive while surviving.
Staring at a stop sign, watching people drive by, T-Mac on the radio. Got so much on your mind, nothing's really going right.